Welcome to Chemistry with Caroline. In this video, we're going to look at the synthesis of epoxides from vicinal halohydrins. So remember that vicinal means next door neighbors, so a halohydrin has a halogen and then an OH group on it. They've got to be next door neighbors like that. And here is my epoxide. You've got a three-membered ring with an oxygen in it. It's strained, but they can be formed, and they are actually found naturally occurring as well. If we don't already have a vicinal halohydrin, we could synthesize one, flashback to chapter 8, from an alkene. So if I added Br2 and water, you get a vicinal halohydrin as a product. So that's another way to access this molecule. This reaction for the formation of the epoxide occurs through an SN2 mechanism. So let's go to the next slide and we'll take a look at how. So the first step in this reaction is making a good nucleophile. This is going to be an intramolecular SN2 reaction. So I don't have a good nucleophile right now. The base in solution can deprotonate my alcohol, and that will give me this molecule. And now I have a good nucleophile, and I also have a leaving group in the same molecule. So this is my nucleophile. There's my leaving group. So if I put my lone pair on oxygen here, it's important that these two are anti to one another. So if we think about an SN2 reaction, it proceeds through a backside attack. The lowest energy pathway electronically and sterically is for those groups to be opposite one another. So if my oxide is up, then my leaving group needs to be down, which is what I have in this case, and then vice versa. It could be switched. So the oxygen nucleophile is going to attack the carbon with the leaving group on it, and then that is going to leave, and that's going to close up my ring and form the epoxide. So this is an intramolecular SN2 reaction. And that would form my epoxide product, okay? So I'm going to write us a note. The nucleophile and the leaving group must be anti to one another. That's the lowest energy pathway. And so in order for the reaction to occur, we have to have that anti or trans setup on our starting material. Of course, we can't miss this opportunity to draw a chair conformation, right? That's what the molecule actually looks like. So if we draw a chair conformation, there's two major ones, right? If I look at my starting material, I have a chlorine that is going up, right? And I have an oxygen that is going down. So I'm drawing this one conformation here, and I'm going to draw the ethoxide so we can sort of see. But do you see how when we look at the actual orientation of the molecule, those are truly anti to one another? When those two are in the axial type positions, chlorine is straight up and oxide is straight down. And so those electrons can come in the back while the chlorine leaves out the front, okay? The other chair conformer, if I did the ring flip, these two are in equilibrium with one another. That chlorine would still be up, right? In a chair conformation, in a ring flip, up stays up and down stays down, but axial and equatorial change. So the chlorine on the left-hand side is up and axial. Here the chlorine is up and equatorial. And then my oxygen is going to be down still, and now it's going to be equatorial. So in this conformation, which is the major conformation, the molecule can't actually do the SN2 mechanism because those aren't anti to one another. They're gauche. They're next door neighbors. And so electronically and sterically, there's too much repulsion going on. This is the actual conformer the molecule is in when the reaction occurs. So this has been a look at how to make epoxides from vicinal halohydrins. If you found this video helpful, please like, subscribe, and share with your friends. Thanks.